For those of you just joining, today we're discussing conference highlights from ASCO GU 2023. Dr. Mantia will be discussing updates in bladder cancer with Dr. Joaquin Belmont as the discussant. Dr. Mantia, take it away.
All right. Thank you, everyone, for joining. So today, I just wanted to discuss a few updates from bladder cancer at GU ASCO this year. So there were no big surprises or practice-changing presentations, but we had some interesting follow-up data from some big trials and then some interesting thought-provoking smaller studies. So in the areas to discuss today, so one major study for non-muscle invasive bladder cancer, KEYNOTE-057, and then for muscle invasive bladder cancer, an update on CheckMate 274, and a couple of trials looking at different methods of bladder sparing. And then in our advanced disease areas, we had a couple updates for some major trials, ATROPHY-U01 for sacituzumab, and then IMvigor 130 for atezolizumab plus platinum-based chemotherapy. And that's not comprehensive. There were a couple of other studies, but these are some of the more interesting ones. So the KEYNOTE-057 trial was looking at pembrolizumab monotherapy for patients with high-risk non-muscle invasive bladder cancer that were unresponsive to BCG. And so this was looking at cohort two. So we had previously heard from the results of pembrolizumab in patients with CIS, and the patients with CIS could have had papillary disease as well, but this is the awaited results from the patients with papillary tumors. So they could have high grade TA or really any T1 disease without CIS. The trial is that the patients get pembrolizumab every 3 weeks for up to 2 years, and they have disease assessments at 12 weeks. Basically, every 12 weeks, they have cystoscopies, urine cytology, and then every 6 months, they have CTU. And so this showed a 43.5% disease-free survival at 12 months. And so this is a little bit better than the data for CIS. This seemed to be pretty durable, actually. So it dropped off to 35% at 24 months, but then this stayed steady with 35% of patients having disease-free survival at 3 years. Progression-free survival with 88% of patients, you know, being free of any worsening of their grade, stage, or death from their disease, and similarly for metastatic disease. The treatment-related side effects are what we would expect, and so overall, about 14% of patients had a serious grade 3 or 4 adverse event. You can see them listed here. You know, the majority of the side effects were pruritus, hypothyroidism, fatigue, but diarrhea was 7%, and a percentage of patients with grade 3 to 4. Everything else was very rare, under 1% of serious related side effects. And then they also looked at patient quality of life. And so for most patients, their quality of life was stable. While they were on treatment, about 20% of patients had an improvement of quality of life, and 30% had a reduction. And so overall, this stayed pretty steady while they were on pembrolizumab. So next, looking at muscle-invasive bladder cancer, we had an update of CheckMate 274. So this is our adjuvant study of nivolumab. Nivolumab is currently approved in this setting. We are awaiting overall survival results. Unfortunately, we don't have those still. We learned that it's going to be a while until we see those, as it's event-driven. But we do at least have an update at 36 months. So we see an ongoing disease-free survival benefit with nivolumab versus placebo in the intention to treat population. And so this is a hazard ratio of 0.71. And then this is more impressive in patients with PD-L1 greater than 1% with a hazard ratio of 0.52. And so at least this data is reassuring that the curves have stayed separated, and we see some ongoing benefit to adjuvant nivolumab. They showed also the subgroup analysis for the ITT population. I think the things to look at of note is that we don't have a lot of patients with upper tract malignancies. And so here for renal, pelvis, and ureter, there's just very few patients. And so you can see the confidence intervals are wide. And so I think what to do in these patients is still a little bit unclear, but keeping in mind, this is a subgroup analysis. Similarly, for PD-L1, less than 1%, still favors nivolumab, just barely crosses 1. But obviously in our patients with PD-L1 high, a very good benefit there. They also showed what's called PFS2, or time from randomization to disease progression on subsequent therapy. And so this was also improved with nivolumab versus placebo. So the next study to talk about are a couple of studies looking at different ways of trying to do bladder preservation. And so this first study is HCRN GU16257. This was presented by Matt Galski. And so this is a phase two trial of combining GemCis with nivolumab and then doing selective bladder sparing in patients with muscle-invasive disease. And so the way they did this study was patients got four cycles of GemCis nivolumab, and then they had clinical restaging. This included a cystoscopy with biopsies, and they had template biopsies, urine cytology, and an MRI. For patients who were felt to be in a clinical CR, they could then decide whether or not to go on active, sort of a surveillance where they didn't have surgery or radiation, but they did have nivolumab for eight cycles, or they could choose to go to cystectomy. For patients who didn't have a CR, they should go right to cystectomy. They had two co-primary endpoints in the study. So one was the rate of complete response, and then two was how did their clinical CR assessment perform in predicting treatment benefit? And they defined that as either being 2 years metastasis-free if the patients didn't choose cystectomy, or if they had an immediate cystectomy, having a path CR. And so to put this in a little bit of context, so the historical CR rate after neoadjuvant chemo is around 30 to 40%. And so in this trial, they saw a clinical CR rate of 43%. Of the 72 patients who underwent the treatment and restaging, they had 33 who were found to be in CR and 39 who weren't. Of the patients who had CR, 32 of them chose not to have a cystectomy and to go on to nivolumab, and one had a cystectomy. Of the patients who didn't have a CR, 34 went forward with cystectomy and five patients were off protocol. So this is showing the patients that were on nivolumab and did not have a cystectomy up front. These are the patients who had a clinical CR. So of those patients, the 33, 70% were found to have bladder intact, metastasis-free survival. And then you can see the patients that recurred here. So really, there were only two patients who developed metastatic disease, and one of those had a local recurrence and cystectomy first. And so this is their 30-month bladder intact metastasis-free survival that you can see. So this is their metastasis-free survival landmark analysis and overall survival. So they found that their clinical CR did predict treatment benefit. So again, that was either having 2 years metastasis-free if you didn't have a cystectomy, or having path CR and a cystectomy. So they had a positive predictive value of 0.96. They also looked at various markers to see if anything correlated with treatment benefit. And they didn't see any correlations other than high TMB. So TMB greater than 10 correlated with bladder intact metastasis-free survival. And that's likely due to the addition of nivolumab with the chemotherapy and then as treatment ongoing. The next study looking at bladder preservation is very different. So this is the RETAIN trial presented by Daniel Guinnessman at Fox Chase. And so this study is different in that they are both mutation driven and then sort of more liberal in the active surveillance. And so patients all received MVAC treatment and had a repeat TURBT. They defined patients who were mutation positive as having alterations, really any alterations in ATM, RB1, FINC-C, or ERK2. If patients were thought to be in a clinical CR and mutation positive, they went on to active surveillance. If patients had anything less than muscle invasive disease, they could make a choice of intravesical treatment, chemo RT, or cystectomy. And again, muscle invasive disease, they could choose radiation or cystectomy. And T3 or greater disease, they went on to cystectomy. So of their patients, they had 37 who were mutation negative, and most of those patients went on to cystectomy. But again, due to kind of their liberal choices, some patients went on to radiation, BCG, and some patients chose active surveillance. Of the patients who were mutation negative and had cystectomy, 15% had a path CR rate. About 30% of patients had less than muscle invasive disease. 23% had node positive disease at cystectomy. 33 patients had mutation positive, and 25 of those were in a CR. And so all of those patients went on to active surveillance. A patient who wasn't in a clinical CR also chose active surveillance. And then three patients with mutation positive went on to cystectomy up front. So one of their endpoints, metastasis-free survival. So in blue, you see the active surveillance patients. They had a 76.9% 24-month metastasis-free survival. And patients who were not on active surveillance had a 70% metastasis-free survival. Of the patients on active surveillance, 38% of them developed metastatic disease. And the patients not on surveillance, 32 developed metastatic disease. So they did not reach their primary endpoint. They just missed it, but their 24-month metastasis-free survival, the lower bound of the confidence interval was 62, and that had to be greater than 64%. They could not say that this approach was non-inferior to our current approach. They also had a high rate of recurrence. To note, 70% of patients that were on active surveillance had some sort of recurrence. Eight of those had a cystectomy, and then some of the patients chose other options such as chemo-RT. And only 46% of the patients on active surveillance were metastasis-free with an intact bladder. I think one of the big problems with the study are that the patients, even when they had a recurrence, often didn't have cystectomy. And so you can see that 8 out of the 10 patients who developed metastatic disease actually had localized recurrence first. And so you can sort of see that some of those patients then didn't have cystectomies or had delayed cystectomies or then developed metastatic disease. He had presented just a brief comparison between the studies. I think they're very different studies, and so I think it's very hard to compare. The HCRN trial used nivolumab and actually used an MRI to determine clinical CR, which I think is important when you're trying to determine response. CT is oftentimes not very reliable in these patients. And so the HCRN trial had 70% of patients bladder intact and alive without metastatic disease compared to 46% with the retained trial. There was a very high rate of developing metastatic disease, 38% in retained versus only 6% in HCRN. So some things to consider as we try to focus on trying to help patients keep their bladders, also minimizing patients failing with metastatic disease. So moving on to advanced disease, just two trials to present out of a few that were presented at GU ASCO. So one was TROPHY-U01. So this is our phase 2 study of sacituzumab govitecan. We're still awaiting results from the phase 3 ongoing trial. We had previously heard about cohort 1, which is patients who progressed after platinum and checkpoint-based therapies. We now at GU ASCO heard about cohort 2. So this is 40 patients with metastatic urothelial who progressed after checkpoint inhibitor therapy, and they were not platinum eligible at the start of therapy. And so we saw an objective response rate of 32% in these patients. And if you took out the patients who also had prior enfortumab vedotin, then the objective response rate was up to 53%. And then duration of response, 5.6 months. And this objective response rate was pretty similar across all subgroup analysis. The clinical benefit rate was 42% when you took into consideration stable disease over 6 months. And so lastly for bladder, just briefly discussing an update of IMvigor 130. And so this is atezolizumab in combination with platinum gemcitabine versus platinum gemcitabine placebo for first-line treatment of metastatic disease. And so this is arms A and C. We saw as an update here that the overall survival results were just barely not significant. So we had for atezolizumab platinum gemcitabine 16 months versus 13.4 without the added atezolizumab. And so this was a hazard ratio of 0.85, and they just missed the bounds for significance. when they looked at patients who received cisplatin instead of carboplatin, there was a bit more of a benefit, but again, didn't reach significance, where there was really no benefit at all for patients receiving carboplatin. And so just to summarize, we had a few trials that kind of reassured what we're doing now as standard of care, and then some interesting new data. So specifically for non-muscle invasive bladder cancer, 35% disease-free survival at 36 months for patients with high-risk non-muscle invasive disease. For our patients with muscle-invasive disease, reassuring data that the progression-free survival benefit was maintained at 36 months. And then some interesting data on ways to try to preserve the bladder in patients and try to establish which patients are responding. And then for advanced disease, some data for sacituzumab, moving this up in earlier lines of therapy with increased response rates. And then chemoimmunotherapy with atezolizumab, platinum, gemcitabine, not showing an overall survival benefit in the first line. So with that, we can take any questions, and I'll invite Dr. Joachim Belmont to make any comments of anything that he thought was interesting of these studies or other studies at GU ASCO.
Yeah, so I think, this has been an excellent summary of nothing practically changing. I would like just only to highlight maybe 2 points here. The non-muscle invasive, we were expecting to see this cohort 2. However, the endpoint is completely different from the cohort 1, that is a CIS, where we were looking for a CR at 3 months. So here the disease-free survival at 12 months was the endpoint. And the concern is now that we have more approved therapies in that space post-BCG, likely these results are not going to be that useful. So nadofaragene is coming, and other drugs. So the gemcitabine docetaxel. So I think it's okay to know that, but it was not really striking data. For the adjuvant, the CheckMate 274, we need to mention that this was a 3 years follow up, and we were expecting to see survival results. And as Charlene has mentioned, because this is event-driven, maybe we are still going to wait for another year just to see any survival data. But one thing that is interesting, and I compared that study with the IMvigor010 that was using atezolizumab. In atezolizumab, we saw that there was a difference in disease-free survival. Meanwhile, the patients were receiving immunotherapy, and then the curves cross. In this study, we have seen that patients only receive 1 year of nivolumab, and despite that, the curves are consistently separated, meaning that the benefit is, or suggesting that the benefit is maintained in terms of disease-free survival. For the bladder preservation, I think, interesting. One combination was including immunotherapy, the other not, and you have, it's all the time risky comparing the outcomes, but we see much better results in the ones that we were using immunotherapy than the ones that were mutation-driven, deciding to give these MBAC and look for bladder preservation. I think it's very difficult just to draw conclusions. And then finally, the trophy one, the data is from a limited number of patients, 32% of responses. And as you have seen, when they remove patients receiving chemotherapy that was supposed to be given in the neoadjuvant setting or EB, that I don't know when they receive EB, maybe patients coming from EV Pembro likely. So then the response rate is coming up to 53.8%. So it's a bit like uncertain results. So one of the suggestions was to put together this post checkpoint inhibitor with a second or third line, so we enrich these cohorts. And then finally, the IMvigor again. So confirming the disappointing results of combining in first line chemotherapy and immunotherapy. Maybe one of the there were two presentations for this IMvigor 130. The second one presented by Bamias, who is a European, they did show the results in patients unfit for PD-L1 positivity, showing a benefit when compared to chemotherapy and in using atezolizumab monotherapy. The reason is that atezolizumab still has the label in Europe for PD-L1 positive, and they stressed that point, that there might be still some benefit in this non-plan subset analysis. So yeah, if there is any comments from the audience, I think.
Yeah, I think, you know, PD-L1 positive is this, but you know, I'm surprised that we haven't seen anything in the OS, even a bit of hazard ratio, to make sure we're not over 1 in CheckMate 274.
Well, for the sake of time, we'll move on. But Dr. Mantia, Dr. Belmont, phenomenal discussion. And with that, we'll wrap up Bladder.